Oliver Twist, or The Parish Boy's Progress, by Charles Dickens. Among other public buildings in a certain town, there is one anciently common to most towns, great or small, to wit, a workhouse. And in this workhouse was born the item of mortality whose name forms the title of this book. For a long time after it was ushered into this world of sorrow and trouble by the parish surgeon, it remained a matter of considerable doubt whether the child would survive to bear any name at all. Yet, after a few struggles, Oliver breathed, sneezed, and proceeded to advertise to the inmates of the workhouse the fact of a new burden having been imposed upon the parish by setting up as loud a cry as could reasonably have been expected from a male infant who had not been possessed of that very useful appendage of voice for a much longer space of time than 3 minutes and a quarter. The patchwork coverlet which was carelessly flung over the iron bedstead rustled. The pale face of a young woman was raised feebly from the pillow, and a faint voice imperfectly articulated the words, "Let me see the child and die." The patient stretched out her hand towards the child, and the surgeon deposited it in her arms. She imprinted her cold white lips passionately on its forehead, passed her hands over her face, gazed wildly round, shuddered, fell back, and died. They chafed her breast, hands, and temples, but the blood had frozen forever. "It's all over, Mrs. Thingamy," said the surgeon at last. He put on his hat, and pausing by the bedside on his way to the door, added, "She was a good-looking girl, too. Where did she come from?"
"She was brought here last night," replied the old woman, "by the overseer's order. She was found lying in the street. She had walked some distance, for her shoes were worn to pieces. But where she came from or where she was going to, nobody knows."
The surgeon leaned over the body and raised the left hand. "The old story," he said, shaking his head. "No wedding ring, I see. Good night." Oliver cried lustily. If he could have known that he was an orphan, left to the tender mercies of church wardens and overseers, perhaps he would have cried the louder. For the next 8 or 10 months, Oliver was the victim of a systematic course of treachery and deception. He was brought up by hand. The parish authorities magnanimously and humanely resolved that Oliver should be farmed, or in other words, that he should be dispatched to a branch workhouse some 3 miles off, where 20 or 30 other juvenile offenders against the poor laws rolled about the floor all day, without the inconvenience of too much food or too much clothing, under the parental superintendence of an elderly female who received the culprits at and for the consideration of 7d/2d per small head per week. The elderly female was a woman of wisdom and experience. She knew what was good for children, and she had a very accurate perception of what was good for herself. So she appropriated the greater part of the weekly stipend to her own use, and consigned the rising parochial generation to even a shorter allowance than was originally provided for them. It cannot be expected that this system of farming would produce any very extraordinary or luxuriant crop. Oliver Twist's 9th birthday found him a pale, thin child, somewhat diminutive in stature and decidedly small in circumference. But nature or inheritance had implanted a good, sturdy spirit in Oliver's breast. He was keeping his 9th birthday in the coal cellar with a select party of 2 other young gentlemen, who, after participating with him in a sound thrashing, had been locked up for atrociously presuming to be hungry, when Mrs. Mann, the good lady of the house, was unexpectedly startled by the apparition of Mr. Bumble, the beadle, striving to undo the wicket of the garden gate. Mrs. Mann ushered the beadle into a small parlour.
"Now, don't you be offended at what I'm going to say,"
observed Mrs. Mann with captivating sweetness.
You've had a long walk, you know, or I wouldn't mention it. Now, will you take a little drop of something, Mr. Bumble?
I drink your health with cheerfulness, Mrs. Mann, said Mr. Bumble.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.